I'm one half of Survive Today. My brother Ed, I'm Mike, and my brother Ed's the other half. We're a team. But yeah, we live in the People's Republic of Illinois, and Illinois is the last state in the union to have a ban on concealed carry of weapons. And back in December, the 7th District Court of Appeals, federal court, said you can't have a ban on concealing, on carrying concealed weapons. You know, there is a right to bear arms. So what they did is they said you've got 180 days, and that expires June 8th. And if by June 8th we don't, the legislature doesn't pass a concealed carry law, then we have what's called constitutional carry, which means anyone who owns the firearm legally can carry it. So that would seem to be a lot of incentive for our morons in Springfield to get off their butts and put together a law that's acceptable to everybody. Well, there's two problems with that. First of all, the people in Springfield are the number one in the country at screwing things up. Right now, financially, we are the 50th out of 50 states. Our financial, if you do business with the state of Illinois, it will take you 7 to 8 months to get paid because they're that far behind on paying bills because they just don't have the money.
Beats. Yeah,
about a year and a half ago, there was an article in the New York Times about this very thing that, you know, they showed the comptroller with a $2.5 billion, you know, not a literal stack of bills on his desk, but $2.5 billion backlog of bills that we just cannot pay until, you know, money comes in and he pays them as he can. Well, now the backlog is at $7 billion. So don't underestimate Illinois politicians' ability to screw things up. So June 8th is fast approaching. And on the morning of June 9th, some people are thinking, well, we'll wake up. They won't have passed a concealed carry ban law. So anybody in the state of Illinois that legally owns a firearm will be able to carry concealed. And while that's true, there's another wrinkle. In Illinois, we have what's called home rule. And I think we may be the only state to have that. And that says, it sounds like a good thing, any entity, whether it's a city or a town or a village or a county that has more than 25,000 people can make up their own rules unless those rules are preempted by a supermajority vote in Springfield. For instance, if Springfield passes a concealed carry law, but it only has 55% of the vote, when it passes in Springfield, Chicago, Cook County, or should I say Crook County, any of 200 bodies of government in Illinois can say, oh, well, that's not a supermajority vote. We have home rule. We can make a more restrictive bill for our city or our village or our town or our county. So what could happen here is if we don't pass a concealed carry bill in Springfield with a three-fifths majority vote by June 8th, we could have 200 different local governments all having their own specific concealed carry laws. And you would have to have a lawyer and a boundary map as you go through the state of Illinois to know, oh, wait a minute, I just passed a county line. Now I'm not legally carrying concealed anymore. Now I'm in violation of the law. It's that crazy in our state.
But what about the courts? Doesn't the court say that they have to have some type of concealed carry? I mean, isn't there some type of limit?
That's where it gets very dicey, because the court order was for the state of Illinois. And Illinois is a peculiar state because of this home rule thing that we have, where, you know, more local control. And just a couple of weeks ago, the Supreme Court decided not to hear an appeal of New York's handgun law, where New York City was basically making it impossible for people to get concealed carry licenses because they were making the, you know, so many hoops that you had to jump through, it was impossible to get one. And instead of hearing the appeal and striking down that law as being excessively restrictive, the Supreme Court said, we're going to let the ruling stand. We're not going to hear the appeal. So, for instance, if you live in New York State, you can get a permit, a concealed carry permit. But if you're in New York City, unless you know someone and you've been a big contributor and you're politically connected, it's never going to happen. Less than a tenth of 1%, from what I understand, of the people have gotten concealed carry permits.
So the U.S. Supreme Court decided to let that stand.
They did. They decided not to.
The so-called conservative U.S. Supreme Court. That many people try to argue that it's a conservative Supreme Court, but I always say that it doesn't matter if a Republican or a Democrat put them in place. They're serving a certain agenda. They're not serving our best interests most of the time.
And I don't know. It might have been a technical thing whereby they thought that this was a narrow ruling or not. But meanwhile, back in Illinois, the Speaker of the House is Mike Madigan. The guy's been Speaker of the House for a couple decades. He can do anything he wants in Illinois. You know, our last two governors are, you know, both in jail. The Speaker of the House can do anything he wants. He runs the state. And his daughter is now Attorney General. And his daughter wants to run for governor. The current governor wants the Attorney General to file an appeal to the Supreme Court of this ruling that says we have to have concealed carry. But Lisa Madigan, because she wants to be the next governor, doesn't want to totally tick off all the gun owners. So she doesn't want to file an appeal. Even though she's for gun control, she doesn't want to be the one to actually file the appeal to the Supreme Court. So she asked for a 30-day delay to take her window that she can file an appeal past this June 8th deadline, basically kicking the can down the street so that she won't have to make a decision. And the person who handles appeals from our part of the country is Supreme Court Justice Elena Kagan. And she said, oh, sure, you can have 30 more days. You've already had 5.5 months to decide if you want to appeal. We'll give you another 30 days. So now Lisa Madigan has political cover, so she doesn't have to be the bad guy. It's just incredible how corrupt and how cowardly, you know, these people are. And yet they keep getting elected because, you know, Chicago, like I've got relatives. They voted Republican all of their life until they died, and now they vote Democrat.
Wow, good old Chicago. But hey, at least they gave us Barack Obama, right?
you forget Carol Moseley Braun.
Oh, well.
Now, it's a shame that she was the first black female senator, but when she was in the Springfield in our state legislature, during her campaign, she got elected in the year of the woman to the U.S. Senate. And Carol Moseley Braun was a state senator, and she had voted against a bill that would have been tough on pedophiles. So during her campaign for the U.S. Senate, during the year of the woman, when she was getting all this money and funding, the reporter said, why did you vote against this bill that would have been tough on pedophiles? And she says, oh, no, that's not true. Well, at her next campaign stop, the reporters caught up with her again and says, we looked it up, you voted against the law. And her response was, and I'm not exaggerating or misquoting it, she said, you know what, that's right, I did vote against it. That was a mistake, but you know, who's to say I wasn't in the bathroom or something when it was being debated? And she became a United States Senator from Illinois. So never underestimate our ability to give you guys our finest politics.
Oh, man. So what do you think is going to happen in Illinois as far as concealed carry?
Well, I'm an NRA instructor, pistol instructor, and, you know, I, in addition to being concerned about the Second Amendment rights, you know, I enjoy giving gun classes. And I think that the current legislation in Springfield that got 68 votes, but it needs 70 to pass, I think it's reasonable. To get a concealed carry permit would require you to go through an 8-hour course, like the NRA basic pistol course, including firing at a man-sized target. And 70% of 30 shots, you got to hit 21 shots. And the man-sized target, which is as big as a man, it's 2 feet wide, 10 shots at 5 yards, 10 rounds at 7 yards, 10 rounds at 10 yards. And every student, all of my students now do that exact qualification at the end of my class, because if that version of the law passes, then they'll be all set to make their application for a concealed carry permit. I don't think that's onerous. You know, I know people say you shouldn't have to have any permit to carry a gun. You know, the Second Amendment is the permit.
Yeah, that's why I love Alaska. But go ahead.
Yeah. Well, maybe I'm a little bit biased because of the fact that I'm an NRA instructor. But I see people that are not, I would shudder to think of them carrying a concealed weapon. So I don't mind an 8-hour class. You've got to go through, in Illinois, like 40 hours of supervised driving as a teenager before you can get a driver's license.
So yeah, you're also a fellow prepper, and you like to, like a lot of us on YouTube, you like to talk about issues involving emergencies, issues involving just preparing for things that could happen, and really just it's really a lifestyle that people don't really understand. They think it's, oh, you're preparing for the end of the world or something like that. No, you know, you're just preparing for life. It could be a house fire. Yeah. It could be a tornado. It could be an economic collapse. It could be some type of natural disaster. It could be a number of things, you know. You're just putting yourself in a better position to respond to emergencies.
Well, I think that if you looked back 100 years, you know, all of our great-grandparents or great-great-grandparents would be, by today's standards, be considered preppers. You know, it's just common sense. You know, you see when the snowstorm hits, you know, the snowstorm is coming. You know, suddenly people run out, and a lot of times if it's going to be a massive snowstorm, the stores will run out of milk and bread and things because people are panic buying. And, you know, it's being a prepper just means that you don't have to watch the weather if you don't want to, because no matter what happens, you got a few weeks of food minimally.
And water. Yeah, and water, definitely. So what are your observations on these scandals, the AP scandal, the IRS scandal, the Benghazi scandal, or, you know, the presidency?
Well, I think it's definitely a second-term curse. You know, like the headline was at Drudge Report, you know, they make these observations about, you know, you have a good first term, you get reelected, and then everything hits the fan in the second term. But that's interesting because they just revealed that Eric Holder and Barack Obama both knew last June, before the election, about the IRS scandal, and they were able to hold the lid on it so he could get reelected. But, you know, it's insane. You know, what Nixon did didn't result in the death of anybody.
Yeah.
And Eric Holder, you know, they were gun running, 2,000 guns to Mexican drug lords, and all sorts of people died, but those are just Mexicans.
There was a massacre of teenagers. There's some party in Mexico. They had a massacre of a bunch of teenagers and it was related to those damn guns, but
yeah,
hey.
Yeah, but, you know, they're just Mexicans. So evidently they don't count, you know. But even an American border agent was killed with those guns. But
Brian Terry.
Yeah, it's insane because I grew up with Nixon being the worst possible American despot. Tyrant, you know, a tyrant who's using the government against people. He had the enemies lists, and it would appear that the IRS and the ATF are you know, doing a lot worse. But you know what? As long as we can watch American Idol and Dancing with the Stars, who cares?
I mean, Nixon, when you think about it, he was pretty petty compared to the drone, unconstitutional drone attacks that Obama's been doing. He actually killed U.S. citizens overseas with these drone attacks. No trial, no nothing. These people are supposed terrorists or sympathizers or whatever. He's completely walking all over the Constitution. And there was a military authorization. Well, there was no congressional authorization for the bombings in Libya. Completely unconstitutional. Again, no impeachment for this president. You know,
you got people in other countries. You know, countries that we don't know how to pronounce their name, or we have never heard of them, or we can't pinpoint them on a map. So the fact that we use a drone to wipe out 25 people at a wedding just so we can get the one bad guy, who cares? They're just foreigners. They're from the third world. It doesn't matter. I'll just turn on, you know, American Idol tonight and watch it. And it just shocks me that we are getting the government that we deserve because we just don't care in this country. And it makes me shudder to think the drone attacks and different things they can do. You know, Nixon, not that I thought what Nixon did was right, but back when Nixon was president, we were on the verge of a civil war in this country. You know, the assassinations of Kennedy and King, the Vietnam War scandal, the Pentagon Papers, all of these things, for the first time ever, people didn't trust the government. For the first time ever. And you've got the civil rights, you had the ERA, you had the Vietnam War, you had all this stuff going on, and Nixon, in his mind, thought that whatever he had to do to keep a handle on things was was right because he feared a civil war, and so he decided he was going to do an Abraham Lincoln. And although he didn't suspend the writ of habeas corpus, he pretty much crossed the line. Where is the justification for what Obama's doing now that's resulting in death after death after death and using the IRS to bully people? And it's freaky. And the funny thing is, hope and change. Let me think. When he got elected, he didn't change defense secretaries. He didn't change Gitmo like he said he would. He didn't, and I'm not saying that I voted for him or against him or anything, because that's neither here nor there, but it's like that song by The Who, meet the old boss, meet the new boss, same as the old boss, So it makes you wonder, well, who's really calling the shots? It's not these candidates.
Yeah, because even if Obama is impeached, it's the system. That's why I try to get people to think about. It's the system. Who's controlling these guys? Who's controlling Bush and Obama? Obama said a lot of things before he ran, while he ran as president. But once he got into there, like you said, first thing he said is going to shut down Guantanamo Bay. Well, that obviously didn't happen. One of the first things he did was provide some cover, some protection for those Bush torturers. And that's really no surprise, because once one president pushes the boundaries, it makes it easier for the next guy to come. It's like once one president gets more power, or he's able to get away with something, then it means the next guy can get away with that, and that person can push the boundaries even more.
There's no president out there that is going to roll back any of this increase in presidential power. They're never going to do it. Like you say, he did it. I might not do it myself, but I want to have the ability to do it. So it creeps and creeps and creeps. And meanwhile, the guys on the other side of, on Capitol Hill, they're just thinking, well, as long as I can have some fundraisers and get reelected, and like Jesse Jackson, another great Illinois congressman. I'm sorry, Reginald, I'm sorry. Everyone I'm naming is African-American. But our two governors in prison are both white. So,
well, yeah, I mean, it's...
Corruption is an equal opportunity employer here in Illinois.
Oh, man, it's absolutely insane. I don't think there's any state quite like that in terms of... at least the amount of corrupt politicians that we know of. There's corrupt politicians everywhere.
I learned that Harry Reid, when he went to Washington, he was blue collar. He didn't have a lot of money, and now he's a mega millionaire. I wonder how that happened.
Well, he's not going to be broke after being in D.C. for all that time. I mean, come on. With all those lobbyists, I mean, come on. There's a reason why a lot of people working as officials in government administrations or governments actually go on to the private sector, and a lot of people from the private sector go on to the government. And, it's like a revolving door, because, you can work in the government and actually shape policy, and then you can go to the private sector and profit from the policy that you helped shape. that's basically what happens.
You know what? Barack Obama promised that he would not have any lobbyists as members of his... Oh, wait a minute. He then made a bunch of waivers and exceptions. Okay, well, forget it. He didn't do that either.
But nobody pays attention. Like you said, nobody really cares. It's just, people don't care about policy when they head to the polls. People care about personality and perception, and it is sort of like a popularity show. It is sort of like the way American Idol used to be, although the ratings are dropping. But anyway, it is sort of like that. People aren't really concerned about the substance. You talk to people about policy, and people don't care about policy. I remember the first election, I would ask people about, well, what about this policy and that policy? Look, people didn't care. It's just, I like this guy, and that's it. He's black like me, or he's half black, and that's good enough for me. People wouldn't say that outright, but, you ask them about policy, and it's pretty clear they didn't know anything about what the hell was going on, and they didn't really care. So when you have populations like this, it's easy to manipulate and easy to control. You're going to have some pretty bad results.
It doesn't look like it's going to end well. And I don't know if it's true or not, or to what extent it's true, but I think Rush Limbaugh says that most schools no longer teach pre-Civil War U.S. history. So they don't learn about the Constitution and the Founding Fathers, and they don't understand what these people died for. So if people don't appreciate their rights, you know, doesn't matter as long as I got my iPhone.
Well, that's true. That's a good point. Although he is a hypocrite because of his stance on, you know, the war on drugs and his own little problems. But I'm not going to go there. But so Rush, I laugh every time I hear him say something. But yeah, it's true. They don't really teach you much of anything in a lot of these schools. I remember when I left high school, I was completely unprepared. I was one of the students who did better on my test scores than a lot of the kids. The standardized testing, which was kind of scary because that MEEP test was pretty easy. But anyway, I remember that I was so unprepared for college. It was just absolutely scary. I'm glad I went to college because I was able to learn some basic skills that I should have learned in high school. It was sort of like an extension of high school for me. As sad as that is, but you know, they don't prepare you. They don't teach you a lot of skills that you really need in the real world. Everything from balancing a checkbook to just really practical skills. They spend a lot of time talking about nothing. Mm-hmm. You know, it's why don't you actually give some of these kids some real skills? You know, forget about Leadership 2000 class where you talk about leadership or whatever, and just actually teach people, I don't care if it's about a 350 engine or something. Give them some type of skills. I don't care if it's home improvement, something. Give them something to work with. Electronics, it's just a complete mess in these schools. We have illiteracy rates that are just absolutely stunning. Like half the kids graduating in Detroit high schools are barely literate. 23% of Americans are functionally illiterate. Our school systems are failing. If you send your kid to a school, you got to understand that you're responsible for that kid getting educated.
Oh,
you
very can't, much so.
You can't expect the government to educate your kid because they're going to put their own little spin on history and everything. They have their own agenda to serve.
Yeah, we adopted 4 children, and our last adoption was a girl from Guatemala. Our last adoption was a girl who was 13 when we started the process, was 15 by the time it ended. And she finally came home to us, and she's in the public schools, and she's taken 3 hours a night to do homework. And I'm trying to help her with her homework, and it becomes very apparent she's got some learning disabilities. Well, it's actually, but she didn't have a learning disability. She had an extremely low IQ. She was above cognitively impaired, which is the new term for mentally retarded. So therefore, she was not learning disabled because for her very low IQ, she was performing up to par, is what you would expect. And I'm like, well, what's the difference? It's a different term. Well, anyway, because what I asked for was an IEP, an independent education plan, where they recognize that she's, you know, drowning, and they do something about it. But they said, well, we're not doing anything about it because she's getting A's and B's. Well, American literature class, one of the 4 pieces of literature that they studied in during the semester was a Brad Pitt movie, and they watched the movie in class. That was American literature.
Oh, was it at least 7?
No, it was Interview with a Vampire.
Well, that's a good one, though. I mean, if you read the book, then I would give you a pass. If they made them read a book, Interview with the Empire, I would give you a pass.
American literature. Anyway, so she graduated. They were going to give her diploma no matter what, but they just gave her A's and B's and just pushed her through the system, and, you know, they just did not care. They did
really?
Not care.
I mean, did they at least read any books? American literature?
No, this particular class was 4 movies, and they watched the movies during class, and then they, you know, so there was no reading in that class.
What the hell is that going to do for anybody? I can't believe this. I mean, it's just absolutely insane.
You know what? If somebody would have told me that, I would have said, yeah, okay, you're exaggerating.
Yeah.
Let me tell you, I went through this. Email after email, we finally got a new counselor, and she stood up for my daughter, so they finally did all the testing that's required by law, because this counselor said, if we don't do this testing, this guy could sue us. So they did all the testing, they jumped through all the hoops and everything else, but they then fired her because she stood up for my daughter, and she rocked the boat and made waves. So, you know, I won't say what school system it was, but, you know, the education system is...
Was this a teacher that stood up, or was it...
Employees.
Was it a teacher or an administrator stood up?
It was a counselor, yeah.
A counselor, okay. Yeah, because otherwise the teachers' union would have been able to protect her, you know, but...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the education system in Illinois is really broken. You need bodies in class because the funding that you get from the state of Illinois is dictated, is determined by how many students you have in class, your attendance. So if I give you the grade that you deserve and discourage you and you drop out, we get less money. So I'm going to give you A's and B's no matter what so that you feel good, you keep coming to class, we have our numbers, and we get our money from the state of Illinois.
You don't learn anything and you don't get any better, but hey, it's, you know, as long as our bottom line is covered.
It's not about the student, it's about the union members, the teachers. And there are good ones there that really care, but the system is stacked against you.
All right, thank you for joining me, man. You're also available on YouTube, Survive2Day. You run the channel with your brother. And just tell us a little bit about what you do on YouTube and some of the projects you're working on.
Yeah, in addition to Survive2Day, with my survive2day.com, I also have a private YouTube channel, and maybe you can put a link in the description box, where I focus on Illinois concealed carry, Illinois gun laws, and, you know, some things of basic, you know, how to draw from a pistol without shooting yourself, things like that. So,
good to know.
You know, more of my NRA instruction kind of thing. So that's taking a lot of my time these days, and it's very fulfilling.
All right. Thank you for joining me, man. And guys, thank you. Thank you for watching. And don't forget, the future belongs to those who prepare for it today. Bye.